NIPS is a very difficult topic to cover, and I think if we start doing NIPS for everyone, we may not do NTs for everyone then, and we may miss out on preeclampsia prediction as well as looking at NT and structures. So I think there has to be a balance of our NT and prediction has to be added. If we do only NIPT, we will miss on those.
Yeah.
So we come on to what can we do if the fetus has got some problem. So how to improve the outcome once we have a disorder that we have. So one is, we are all here learning fetal medicine is because fetal medicine is a separate subject. The fetus is a separate entity, and we have a whole fetal life in utero before it comes out into the outside world and becomes a child outside. So, and we have, the only tool we have is an ultrasound, which is an extended hand to palpate the fetus, so see the anatomy, look at the pathology, and then treat the fetus also. And previously we would only see the fetus, let the baby go till term, let the baby be born, let the pediatrician look at it, and then the disease would have already become uncorrectable. So we have these therapies which are now available, not for everything, but there are certain conditions where maybe treatment may help, and not with major surgical instruments, with needles and coils that we have. So if we want to improve the neonatal outcome, one is the diagnosis, which we've been talking about since morning, whether we diagnose a disorder, whether we can terminate infections, aneuploidies, and all that. Second is, if we have a structural abnormality, we monitor. That also has been spoken about how to monitor, let it go till whatever time we want to take it and bring it out in a good condition. But the in between is, can we do some therapy inside? And so this could be medical, it could be surgical, and that is what I'm going to talk on in the next. And we all are doing, the first thing is transplacental therapy. So that means we are treating the mother and then treating the fetus with this. And steroid is what we are giving to everybody. That's the first treatment, which is transplacental, to improve the lung maturity for all our mothers who have got a child who might deliver preterm. And also the Maxalt that has to be given for neuroprotection between your 26 weeks to about 32 to 34 weeks. Everybody who has a risk of preterm, when they go into labor, when it is impending preterm, Maxalt needs to be given for neuroprotection. So now coming to medical therapies. So again, transplacental medical therapy. That is, again, we are treating probably the mother and then treating the fetus. So we have hypothyroid fetuses also with goiter, fetal arrhythmias, and for congenital adrenal hyperplasia. So here we have this patient who was 24 weeks referred for polyhydramnios. This polyhydramnios was because there was a huge thyroid gland which was enlarged in the neck, causing obstruction, and that obstruction was causing polyhydramnios. So this was a thyrotoxic mother who was on antithyroid drugs, and so the cause for this. So we did a cord blood sampling, and it came out that the fetus was hypothyroid because of the drugs which were being given to her. So in these patients, if we need to treat this fetus inside, you can give intra-amniotic instillation of levothyroxine. So the baby, as soon as you put it into the amniotic fluid, it gulps and drinks it, and then it goes into the fetus. And we also reduce the dosage of the antithyroid drug, so that we need to keep the maintained dosages. The mother was a little mildly kept on thyrotoxic levels, so that the baby could be kept on a good level. And so the baby came out, and baby is doing well now, 2 years old. So next, coming on to supraventricular tachycardia. Again, this is a disorder, if you have got contractility like this, with time, if it is persistent for a long time, the baby in utero will get high drops and may die in utero. So if you leave it like this, if it is intermittent, you can wait, but if it is persistently like this, it will cause high drops. And so this 27-weeker, we would not want to take it out at this moment of gestation. So we may need to treat this fetus inside. So either we can treat it with digoxin to the mother, which goes to the fetus, or flecainide, sotalol, amiodarone. This would depend on whether there is high drops developed or not developed inside. So third is a heart block. Again, heart block is something where if you leave it for a long time, a complete heart block will further lead on to hydrops in the baby. And this we need to first find out why it has happened. So it could be structural. If there's an atrioventricular septal defect, it can cause a heart block. But if it is structurally completely normal, you need to look at autoantibodies. So you need to look at SLE and look at anti-Rho, anti-La antibodies. Although by now, if there is a heart block, it would already have damaged the Purkinje fibers. It may not improve it completely, but maybe we could start them on steroid dexamethasone 4 milligram. It may not completely treat it completely, but we may need to start. But at least for the next pregnancy, we would be more careful. So this baby, cesarean at 37 weeks, severe IUGR because she was an SLE patient and with the heart block and postnatal pacemaker was given. The most important of RH treatment that we have and has got good results is an intrauterine transfusion. So we do these transfusions for RH negative that we spoke about in our infection panel, but also for parvovirus infection, for fetal anemia polycythemia sequence sometime, and sometimes when there's death of one of the baby inside. And second is a fetal reduction. So RH negative, we know there is an antibodies which are inside. If it is an immunized mother, these antibodies cross the placenta, go to the fetus, may cause hemolysis, may cause anemia, and then that is the pathology behind an RH isoimmunized fetus. So what are we trying to treat is the treating of the fetal anemia, and that we look at the MCA PSV. So if the velocity is above 1.5 mom at whatever weeks of gestation, we would will have to start intrauterine transfusions. This can be done transplacental cord or into the intrahepatic one. And this is when the MCA PSV reaches 1.5 mom. So every patient who is RH negative with titers which are positive, MCA PSV needs to be done and monitored. You don't need to start transfusion as soon as titers come positive. You may have almost 70% patient who will not require a transfusion, but once it value reaches an anemia value, you need to start the transfusion. And when you do this, we need to anesthetize the baby first. So here you can see that's the baby's gluteal region and the needle inside that. So you need to have it anesthetized for some time till we do our transfusion. So you do it with pancuronium, and then intrauterine transfusion is started. It has to be very accurate into the vein, and you can see that needle inside the placental cord insertion site, and you can see that jet of blood coming inside. So while you're doing this, you also need to look at the heart as we are doing the transfusion. So you can see the heart also on the side, and if there's bradycardia, we may need to stop it for some time. So these are very accurate requirements that needs to be done. So that's the liver of the baby, and that's the needle that I'm going in from. And you need to go in with a jab inside. You can't hold the baby. You can't do it slowly because the baby will keep moving. So you go into the hepatic portal vein and you can start the transfusion. Before that, the baby is already anesthetized, so probably the amount of pain will be less. And so you reach into the vein and you can see now that the transfusion has started into the vein, and you can see those jet of blood that we are seeing. So where to do will depend on what is the position of the cord and which is more accessible or not. Very rarely, if you have a sudden intrauterine demise in a monochorionic twin, a monochorionic twin will cause acute hemorrhage into the normal twin. So this was a patient stage 4 TTTS, came at night, and we thought we will do something in the morning, and then there was an IUFD early morning next day. So we know it is within 24 hours of the demise, and there are studies which say that if there is fetal anemia, the MCA-PSV was high, if you give transfusion, it may reduce down the neurological damage. So this was difficult because it's a TTTS baby where one is very severe IUGR, severe polyhydramnios, the cord is very far away, but you can go into the cord and do the transfusion. This is not for anything, it is for preventing neurological damage to the baby which is now alive inside. And so this one MRI done, and even at birth also another MRI done, and the baby is well. So last of all, what is excellent for fetal medicine for improving outcome is these fetal reductions in these IVF pregnancies, and so boom of infertility, and the treatments that we have is higher order pregnancies are coming up, so you need to reduce the risk of preterm, and this needs to be done at 11 to 14 weeks. Earlier we would do at 8-9 weeks, but I think all over the world it is 11 to 14 weeks once we've looked at the baby completely. So you need to do a non-directive counseling, tell them the risk of the reduction as well as the risk of keeping those babies inside with preterm. So the reduction increases the gestational age by at least 4 weeks, and the risk of a pregnancy loss is about 3 to 4% in good hands. The number of fetuses you have and the number that you reduce, the risk increases by the numbers that you have. So if you have 5, the risk is more. If you have 3, the risk may be a little lesser than that. So first you have to screen all these babies. So it needs a screening, takes a longer time than the reduction itself. So you need to do an aneuploidy screening by scan itself, label all those fetuses, you need to look at all of them, and then the one which is smaller in size, the one where the NT is increased, where some structural abnormality is seen, and if all of them are completely normal, then you probably want to do the one which is at the top, and because the one which is at the top is the easiest to do, and probably the spotting and bleeding is less when you do. So here we have this unfortunate baby, which I think is the top one which I want to do. Mm-hmm. And so because it's a trichorionic triamniotic triplets, then we can do is put in KCL inside. The KCL would not go to the others. So we can only put chemicals inside when it is a chorionicity is different. So chorionicity is the most important thing to do. So you can see that needle which is going in. Again, it has to go in with a jab. It has to reach the heart, and then about 0.5 ml of KCL, and it does the work for us. It has its own risk, so you need to tell the patient when you're doing, because these are extremely precious pregnancies and need to be done very accurately. So in addition, we have this selective feticide. It is not triplets or quadruplets, it is two fetuses when one of the baby is abnormal, especially if we find one baby which is chromosomal, one baby which has structural abnormality, or there is a severe discordancy in the growth, or very rarely in TTTS if it's a severe IUGR and a trapped fetus. Reduction would depend on what is the history of this disease of this child. If this baby is going to affect the pregnancy, or if this baby is to be born at birth with lot of morbidity, you may want to do reduction in these cases. Like this was a pediatrician who came at 40 years old herself, IVF pregnancy, TCTA with one spontaneous reduction, said, do I do a screening test? So with reduction done, you can't do a screening test, but on a good scan, NT nasal bone okay, and second baby no nasal bone, NT is increased, say some CPs, pelvic tests. So I was worried that this one baby is going to be Down syndrome. So we would want to test both the babies. So we want to prove first that the baby is abnormal and then decide to do a reduction, not do without proving it. So we would want to do, it's a dichorionic diamniotic placenta. So one through the anterior placenta, you can see my needle going in. And the second one we would do in the posterior placenta. So you would see the CVS being done. So you see that needle coming into this placenta. So both babies are tested, both the babies were investigated, and one of them really came out as trisomy 21 and had to be terminated. So if you don't screen, you don't test, you will not be able to find it, and you will have a Down's baby born along with a normal baby. Here again, this is a baby which has got an encephaloceal. Now, encephaloceal may not have much implications at birth, but it will cause preterm, it will cause polyhydramnios, it may affect the other baby. And so since DCDA twins, we would, last 2 minutes. So KCL reduction can be done in these cases. Last of all, monochorionic is more tricky. In monochorionic twins, we would not be able to put in KCL, and their cord occlusion is what needs to be done. So it can be done by bipolar, laser, or radiofrequency ablation. So if it is causing damage to this fetus, like here you have an anencephaly, where we would want to do a, we can't put in KCL. So what we are doing here is, we are doing an interstitial laser. So you are going into the cord area, and you would want to burn this fetus because no kind of chemical can be used in this case. And you would see it in a second or so that there is burn that will start off here. and you can see some fumes coming out from there. So you will have to do some method of cord occlusion. And second, what you can do is go to the cord, burn that cord off. So like a bipolar cord occlusion, you go and hold that cord and burn it off. And that is the second method that we can do monochorionic pain. And last of all, if you have got IUGR and it's a pre-terminal IUGR, you may actually go and do a radio frequency ablation in these cases. So you cannot let one baby die in a monochorionic twin. You'll have to either deliver both of them together, or you can do is a radio frequency ablation and burn that vessel from the cord area of the baby, which is abnormal. Trapped fetuses, again, you can do an RFA, which is available. So I think next things can be covered up later on. So I would last have one case to show you, which is a shunt. In pleural effusion, we may do ultrasound guided shunt. So this patient who had a huge pleural effusion and a big extralobar pulmonary sequestration with severe hydrops, very bad hydrops at 29 weeks of gestation, there was no chance at all whatsoever, and you can see that fluid is there. And so we put a thoracoamniotic shunt inside. We did a karyotype, everything was okay. So we put in a shunt inside, and then the baby was born, and we would intubate the fetus at the time on the table, and the baby after that had hydrops, monitored, the pulmonary sequestration which we had was operated in a less than 1 kg baby, and then the baby went home alive. Thank you.